if there were any evidence whatsoever that the famine that took place in Ukraine, and it took place elsewhere too, it took place in Russia, it took place in Kazakhstan, if there were a shred of evidence that it was deliberately caused, we would all know about it. None has ever been found.
Mira que ya viene la revolución, para que se asustan será pa' mejor. Es el pueblo entero el que ya está gritando, viva la revolución.
Iranian nuclear weapons development.
They have turned the island into a communist hellhole.
The experiment in Venezuela has failed completely.
What I want to do is I want to play a clip from, this is our favorite media outlet, and I say that sarcastically, Radio Free Europe, basically giving a summation of what the Holodomor is. And these are some of the standard talking points, right? Just as Dr. Furr was saying, Stalin woke up one day, he was angry, and he's this crazy guy who just decided to purposely starve millions of Ukrainians to stop their nationalism, to stop their separation from the Soviet Union. And so we're going to play this clip and we'll debunk a few more of the talking points that are common when it comes to talking about the so-called Holodomor.
In the early 1930s, millions of Ukraine's people died in a devastating famine. Known as the Holodomor, it is one of the most tragic chapters in Ukrainian history. When Ukraine became a part of the Soviet Union in 1922, it was the country's breadbasket, thanks to its fertile fields of wheat. In 1928, Soviet leader Joseph Stalin introduced collectivization, which was supposed to unite privately owned farms into state collective farms called kolkhoz. The Soviet leadership argued that collective farms would be more effective and produce a surplus, which would feed industrial workers. As many Ukrainian peasants were not willing to hand over their land to the state, their fields were confiscated. Many of them were sent into exile or abandoned their homes. In 1932, the government's quota on crops was raised significantly, and farmers were expected to harvest more than before. For many, it was a target that was impossible to meet. What grain they produced was confiscated with nothing left for them or their families. Farmers who hoarded their crops were often punished or executed. The exact number of people who died in the famine of 1932 and 1933 is still not known. Historians estimate that between 3 and 12 million people perished, most of them ethnic Ukrainians. For decades, the existence of the famine was denied by the Soviet Union. Historians in Russia and the West disagree as to whether the famine was man-made and if it was a deliberate attempt to eradicate Ukrainian independence. Since 2006, Ukraine and 15 other countries have recognized the Holodomor as a genocide against the Ukrainian people.
So a lot of imperialist propaganda there. We'll get into that in a second. I just want to play one last clip before we pass it over to Dr. Furr to respond to that. This clip is a trailer for a film called Bitter Harvest, which is basically a cinema version of this propaganda talking points, and then we'll play this, and then we'll talk about the mythology of the Holodomor.
I was born in a country where anything was possible. We celebrated simple freedoms to live and to love.
Marry me.
But there have always been those who would try to take our freedom.
Ukraine must be taught to bow to our will. Without its vast harvest of grain, Russia cannot exist. Take all their food.
This would mean the death of millions.
Who in the world will know?
Coming! Bolsheviks!
Your land all belong to the state.
I have seen people left to die.
This is not a famine. This is starvation. I must fight for my country.
Resistance is strong and spreading.
Close the borders, keep them in.
We must save ourselves or die.
Know that I'll always be yours.
Trust me, I will make it home to you. How many lives is this war worth?
If I can save one life, that's enough for me.
We must continue the resistance.
Freedom! Freedom! To Ukraine!
Having someone to live for gives me courage. We will be together again.
I've never seen so much propaganda in a short time, a minute and a half. That's a record. The music, the portrayals of Stalin, and just really fascinating to see. Dr. Furr, your reaction to the common talking points about the Holodomor that we mentioned in Radio Free Europe, and also the Bitter Harvest film as well, because I know you've written about that.
Sure. Well, let me start by telling your listeners that the... there are some serious historians who have worked on these questions of Soviet agriculture, Russian agriculture, famines included. I have read many of them. The best, by far, scholar of this field, a person who is not a leftist in any sense of the word, is a professor at West Virginia University named Mark Tauger, T-A-U-G-E-R. I got to know his work beginning about 20 years ago, and have followed everything he has written since then. I've also gotten to know him somewhat. And it's clear that he and I are politically not on the same page. You know, he is not a leftist, not even, let's say, a social democrat, much less to the left of that, right? But be that as it may, the issue is really not that. The issue is that history, like chemistry or physics, can be objective. Okay, it is possible to come to objective conclusions, conclusions that are not based simply upon replicating political viewpoints, by sticking to certain rules of investigation, including primary sources and drawing your conclusions from primary sources, you know, by legitimate, rational means, so that anyone who is determined to get at the truth and to write history from an objective viewpoint can do so regardless of their own political preferences or views. All right? So in saying that Tauger is not a leftist, I don't mean to imply that if he were a leftist, I mean, I'm a leftist of some kind. That doesn't mean to imply that if you have certain political views, that disqualifies you and what you write. And by the same token, the Ukrainian nationalist research isn't invalid simply because they're right-wing Ukrainian nationalists, all right? Their views are not supported by the evidence, but Tauger's are. Now, most of his works are available online in one place or another. And I'll tell you where in a minute. You can look for them. But if you do simply do a search, let's say a Google search for Mark Tauger, M-A-R-K-T-A-U-G-E-R, you can find them. And I have studied them very closely for years, and he has studied the primary source material. And it's very clear that this business of the Holodomor is a complete fabrication. And if you go into the history of the fabrication, it turns out it was the pro-Nazi Ukrainian nationalists back in the 30s who began to write about that and then continued after the war to do it. These people are also anti-Semitic. And so the term Holodomor was certainly chosen in part to sound like Holocaust. All right. In fact, there's even a book published by these Ukrainian fascist emigres in Australia back in the 1980s called Why Is One Holocaust Worth More Than Another? And what they mean is, well, more people were killed in the Holodomor Holocaust by the communists than were killed in by the Nazis. And the Jews were killed by the Nazis in the regular Holocaust. And yet nobody's talking about our Holocaust. OK, so that the term was picked in part to sound like Holocaust. Tauger has written an awful lot of stuff. And two things, I want to mention two things here. First of all, he wrote an excellent review of Bitter Harvest, that movie you're talking about, which goes point by point through the whole movie and simply tears it to shreds. Okay? It's a lie from beginning to end. Secondly, he has written an excellent review, which is also available online, of Anne Applebaum's book, Red Famine. Okay, and he was initially asked to do this by a leading Soviet studies, Russian studies journal, Kritika. And I read, he sent me, was kind enough to send me the rough draft of his review. But the rough draft of his review is clearly so biting, so such a devastating demolition of this dishonest book, Red Famine, that Kritika wouldn't publish it, even though they had asked him for it. But he got it published elsewhere, and it is available online. So I would just like to say that my understanding of the famine and the history of collectivization in the Soviet Union is shaped largely by studying Tauger's research. Although when it comes to the issue of collectivization itself, I've also studied some of those primary sources. There's plenty of evidence. I want to assure your listeners and you yourself that if there were any evidence whatsoever that the famine that took place in Ukraine, and it took place elsewhere too, it took place in Russia, it took place in Kazakhstan, if there were a shred of evidence that it was deliberately caused, we would all know about it. None has ever been found. So naturally, you won't find any. But what Robert Conquest discovered back in the 80s, writing that book, Harvest of Sorrow, which is first sets forth this notion of deliberate famine in English, and then what the Ukrainian nationalists found out is that you don't need to have evidence. The only people who are really interested in evidence are scholars. They're the only people who have the time to look at it, evaluate it, and so forth. And they're not really interested in convincing scholars, especially since they have no evidence. They can't convince them. Even the anti-communist ones can't be convinced. So they publish in publishers which are not academic publishers, and they publish in popular and semi-popular magazines. They get into newspapers. They make movies. Movies, of course, are by definition fiction, right? Bitter Harvest does not claim to be a documentary. It's fiction. Well, these are all actors, right? So therefore, if it's fiction, you know, it's but they know very well that people watching this will think, well, these events happened. You know, maybe the love story between these two young people didn't happen. You know, maybe certain events are fictionalized. But these events happen. Sort of like if you watch a Civil War movie, you know, a movie about the Civil War. Well, it may be, you know, the basic plot line may be fiction, but you know, there really was a civil war and everybody knows it, right? So people will assume, well, you know, the basic plot line of Bitter Harvest may not be true, but there really was a man-made famine. Well, that's not the case. Okay. So this is the situation we're dealing with. We're dealing with a situation where the semi-popular and popular media, television, newspapers, magazines, the people who write for them simply don't have time to do the research, right? Journalists don't do research. Journalists report what other people say. And so it's possible, if you keep at it and you know how to go about it, to leapfrog over the scholarly community and to just go directly to the mass consciousness, all right, with these popular and semi-popular vehicles such as newspaper articles, magazines, and especially film. And you can have a tremendous effect on the way people think without worrying about the fact that what you're saying is completely false, right? And that's what the Ukrainian nationalists have done. And of course, it's not like they invented this. They took a page from the Nazis. And I have to tell you that the Nazis took a page from Western racists and anti-communists, whom they themselves learned from. So this kind of thing also goes on in mainstream Soviet studies, although it is interesting that no mainstream scholar in the West agrees that the famine was man-made. However, there's the disagreement that does exist among scholars in the West is whether or not the famine was caused by collectivization. Stephen Kotkin seems to assume that, although he does not say that in so many words in his enormous volume 2 of his biography of Stalin. He says Stalin created the famine any number of times in that book, but he never explains how Stalin is supposed to have done that. One has to assume that he must assume himself that it was done by collectivization, but he never even tries to show that. Tauger shows very convincingly with primary source evidence that collectivization did not cause the famine at all. All right. The famine had natural causes. Drought in some places, flooding in other places, infestations of mice, insects, and some particularly devastating plant diseases called colloquially smut and rust, which are very hard to detect until it's too late, until the crop is already, the crop of wheat is already grown up, and then you discover that the wheat, the blades and the seeds of wheat are all dead. So this is what caused the famine in 1932-33.